didn't ask you that I wondered about was whether you have a view on how much fear there might be around decision making, and whether fearing making a wrong decision is a lot of the reason why it gets so close to or gets to court.
Yes, I think fear, particularly around making risky decisions, or fear around making decisions that might mean that somebody gets hurt or indeed dies, are really, people are risk averse in health and social care. So I've had a few cases of men with Korsakoff syndrome who want to drink alcohol and are in care homes that are preventing them from doing that. That's clearly something that people want the best for P, and often what they mean by the best is safety and health. And when P doesn't want that for him or herself, it's tricky. The other thing I should have said and didn't is that I've been talking as if everything's online and is going to be online forever. And actually, we don't know what's going to happen when the public health crisis is resolved, which at some point I assume it will be. So we're already seeing some move back into physical courts. I don't know whether we will be allowed to continue to have remote access to physical courts or not. I know journalists are very concerned about this. In many ways, having remote access is a privilege and a benefit from the public health crisis that has made it a lot easier for many of us to watch court hearings without traveling to distant cities for hearings that then may be adjourned or vacated, just as much as the online hearings are.
You can't have your backup in the same way, certainly not if they're in different geographical locations. So it's then a much bigger commitment to make, isn't it, to travel all that way potentially and not see anything for a while.
Exactly. Exactly. So I think one message is, I don't know how soon you're going to get this video out, but one message is, do it now before we're all back in physical courts again.
You can't just accept that we do it the way we've always done it, for example. And I think the conversation we've had today shows that very much. You know, the courts have had to move to something rather different, which has given an amazing opportunity.
And they've done it remarkably rapidly and remarkably smoothly under the circumstances. And I started off as a skeptic and as someone quite hostile to remote justice, and I've been completely converted to the benefits of it and the fact that empathy and sensitivity and care can be done, which shouldn't be that surprising. I mean, my supervisions have moved online as well, and she's just as empathetic and caring towards me as she was face-to-face. Counselling has moved online. You know, so many sort of psychological and therapy-based things have always been done online and are being increasingly done online, and if they can do it online, so can judges, so can lawyers.
Absolutely. I think we thought we'd be okay with clients we knew, but we weren't so sure about new clients building rapport. And obviously it doesn't work for absolutely everyone, particularly when you're talking about people with neurological problems, but it's been way better than anyone thought. And everybody you speak to says that. And we always had these tools in the toolkit. We've been forced now to explore what we can really do with them.
Yes.
And I think that is fantastic. I'm quite sure we'll go back to some of the other ways of doing things too. And like any tool in the toolkit, it should be one of many, and you should be selecting for the right reason when we can do that again. But this has given us a lot, I think.
One of the things that struck me about the court hearings is when offered the choice, P and P's family say they want remote hearing for the next hearing. So P may be in a hospital bed or a care home, and P says, you know, I can't attend if you expect me to come to court, or I don't want to be the only one on video link when everybody else is there in person. I want everybody there on the same basis. So have an online hearing for me, please. And that P's family, especially when they're carers, are saying, look, it's a huge hassle to try to arrange somebody to care for P. Can we please have it online again? This has been fab. So there's a lot of enthusiasm from P&P's family for the online remote hearings as well.
Yeah, I think that's what it's wonderful that, you know, something that is perhaps, it feels to me that with quite a lot of our clients, something that has perhaps given us bigger challenges has actually not done so to the same extent for some of our clients.
Well, the challenges for professionals has sometimes been to get the technology into people's homes, because people haven't got laptops or don't know how to connect or can't physically mentally use a service. It has to be set up for them, an online platform. So there has been, I think, an amazing amount of people's solicitors going into their homes, masked up sometimes and everything, to set up with their spare laptops, setting them up for clients, getting it working for them. You know, I've been so impressed. I think it's been amazing.
I know it's not altogether the case with everything, but it's nice when there are moments where the challenge is greater for the professionals and yes, not so great for the clients. That is an amazing thing, because so much of life is the other way around for the kind of clients that I work with, and it's been a bit of a lesson. And just, you know, the sort of seeing bits of people's homes and things like that, which I know some people say feels intrusive, but we've certainly had clients who've reflected that, you know everything about me. It's quite nice to see a little bit about you, actually, and you only show what you are comfortable with.
Yeah, and I think it's more democratic as well. The feeling of having everybody as a little face on screen, as opposed to having the judge on the dais up in front and, you know, everybody ranked in the courtroom in order. And so many people feel more able to participate. And I think when P is in court, P doesn't know the court rules. P will just pop up at any time and say, "Oi, that's wrong." And the judge will have to go, no, this is a courtroom. But people just keep going sometimes. And I've watched some quite assertive peas who've taken over the courtroom in a way that I just don't think they would have felt able to do or would have been physically removed in other contexts.
I notice when you have quite a lot of people on the screen, sometimes, I don't know why it happens, but sometimes everyone moves around, so, which is slightly confusing because you thought you were talking to this person here and they're suddenly somewhere else. But it strikes me that there's also nothing on the screen that's hierarchical about it. Zoom arranges itself however it arranges itself, and it's things, but possibly quite important thing.
And judges are getting used to doing things like using separate rooms to talk to P when P doesn't want to be seen by everybody. And judges have become familiar with a range of different platforms, some of them now. So I think, you know, the uncertainty and anxiety and stress level on judges I was detecting in May was phenomenal. I mean, they were just at the end of their tethers. But now I'm seeing some quite relaxed judges who are coping really well with the technology, and more than coping well, are using it productively to have things happen that couldn't otherwise have happened, like visiting P in the hospital bed. So somebody has said that because of coronavirus, judges aren't talking to P. Well, that's absolutely not right. Because of coronavirus, judges have more opportunity to talk to P than before, because they're now at the forefront of their mind, oh, could I do it via Zoom or Skype or something? And yes, they can. So,
well, and judges, P and everybody else, are not tying up lots of their time travelling. I mean, everybody's got a bit more time. I've noticed it starting to creep up again, but time has been a lot more flexible and people are easier to get hold of.